Forget.
No.
All right, shit. Here we go. Yeah.
I guess, Jonathan, my father, it's up to you how you want to ask questions. I mean, it's like sometimes it's quite difficult to see if people raise a hand on that. So I guess either I can try Elodie, and I can have a look at the chat, or if you want, we can just leave it at the
Yeah,
end.
we'll keep an eye, but if we don't see it, please interrupt us and just let us know.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, questions at any time, of course. And yeah, if someone could just let us know if it's a question we haven't noticed. So.
I'll try to keep a lookout. If you miss something, just shout out, I guess. That's
Yeah, just
the
shout
cool
out.
thing. Yeah,
Works.
I mean, like
Good
that's
old.
probably it. We are not so many, so that should be fine.
Yeah, good old shout out. Yeah.
I suppose there'll be raucous delay. Sorry.
I can just say, if you are looking, we are actually, this is the last scheduled meeting we have right now. So we had to find new speakers for next month, 2 months. If someone has any good ideas, I mean, send me or anyone in the leading group an idea, and we'll try to do it. We haven't really got started off the summer yet. So we have some ideas, but we haven't planned anything yet. But hopefully we will have a good speaker in a month's time again. But if you have any good ideas, or if you want to speak yourself, just send me an email, or send someone, one LOD or Sergey is here, and an email, and that's we'll try to arrange things. I guess we can start.
Very well.
Okay, so hi everyone. I hope you all had a great summer. Thank you for coming back to our CASP Zoom. And so we'll start the season today with Mafalda Diaz and Jonathan Frazer from the Center for Genomic Regulation in Spain. And they will talk about increasing diagnostic yield of patient sequencing with proteome scale probabilistic modeling.
Great. Well, thank you very much for having us.
Yes, thank you. I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to restart Zoom so that I can share screen. So I'll be right back. Yeah, it's a new computer. Sorry.
Bye-bye.
See you soon.
Mute. Sorry. Can you see the screen and the mouse? Yes. Thank you. Sorry, we were muted. Okay. Yes. Yes. Thank you so much for welcoming us here today. Like Elodie said, we are at Center for Genomic Regulation now, and we just started our group, and we develop models of the effect of genetic variation, broadly speaking. So we're really interested in the kind of information that the diversity of genetic variation seen on Earth at different time scales. And today we're going to talk about variation across the tree of life, and also variation within the human population. We'll give you an example of that. But what all of these variations can teach us about the diversity of molecular function and phenotype. And we are particularly interested in disease phenotype, what can be broadly put under the umbrella of evolutionary medicine. And actually, we're starting a program here at CRG on evolutionary medical genomics. And today, we're going to give you a specific example on how models of the effect of genetic variation can help the increasing the diagnostic yield of patient sequencing. And this is a very timely problem, because at the moment sequencing is getting increasingly used for diagnostic care. I mean, whole exome sequencing is getting standardly used for diagnostic care for rare disease in some countries. There's even newborn sequencing pilot studies being discussed in the UK and other places. But the reality is that what we get from all of these patient sequencing is still very small. So if you think about diseases living somewhere in this spectrum from polygenic to monogenic, complex disease lives somewhere here where you have lots of common variants with small effects contributing to the disease. And in that case, it's actually quite hard to have a genetic diagnostic. So even in cases like Alzheimer's, that is a very well-studied disease where we can predict 60 to 80%, depending on the twin study, predicted heritability, but less than 30% of that can be explained with what we currently know of the genetics of this disease. The situation you would have imagined that maybe it's easier for a rare disease because we're somewhere here in this spectrum where we have most likely a single or a few genetic causes that are very large effect and very rare, but large effects that are driving the disease. But even in that case, the diagnostic yield of patients is very low. So a very interesting project is these 100,000 genomes projects from the UK, shows that for their study, less than 35% of the patients got diagnostic after being sequenced. So to understand why this is the case and what are the main bottlenecks, it makes sense to look at large cohorts of patients. And this one that I'm going to talk about, like, we're going to go back over and over to this data of this patient cohort, has 31,000 trios of patients with severe developmental disorders. When I mean trios, I just mean the patient and the parents, so that we really have a notion of the de novo mutations that are occurring in the patients. Something that is very striking when you look at this data is that there is a huge excess of loss of function variants in this cohort compared to what you would expect, and also a very large excess of missense variants compared to what you would expect in a cohort of this size, really sort of kind of indicating that a lot of the disease etiology, genetic etiology, might be harbored within this excess of loss of function and missense variants. Then when you go and look at what we know so far, 70% of the excess of loss of function can be explained by known disease genes, but the vast majority of the excess of missense variants is in genes that are not currently known to be associated with disease. This basically just tells us that, well, on one hand, most of what we know currently of the genetics of rare disease is dominated by loss of function, but it really also says that our lack of knowledge of the effects of missense variants is one of the big bottleneck for the diagnostic of rare disease patients. So why is this the case? You could imagine that since there is a huge burden, we can see that there is a burden of or an excess of these missense variants across the cohort, that maybe looking at the burden gene by gene would be helpful to identify genes that are associated in disease. And in fact, this kind of gene level burden test has been very heavily used by the community and is very powerful. And the idea here is very simple. It's just that you look at the probability. There's different ways of doing this burden test here. I'm just giving an example that uses a Poisson distribution, where you basically just look at what is the probability of seeing a given number of variants given the cohort size and the background mutation rates. And you can get a notion of how unexpected it is to see this excess given to what you would expect. These gene level burden tests have taught us a lot about disease gene associations, but they're also limited, mainly because rare disease sometimes is extremely rare. And even in huge cohorts of patients like this one, there's 31,000 patients with severe developmental disorders, you can see that the genes that are currently known to be associated with disease have a lot of de novo missense variants. So there's kind of like a long tail of de novo missense variants per gene. Whereas all of the other genes that are known to be associated with disease, where we know that a lot of the burden of excess of missense variants are somewhere harbored in these genes, are dominated by genes that only have 1, 2, 3, or 4 de novo missense variants in them. So this is basically saying that it's going to always be very hard to discover via burden test genes for which there's very low number of variants in them. And ultimately, there's the impossible challenge of how can we ever recognize causal variants in disorder that are only seen as once in a cohort large like this. So our talk today is going to be about how can we bring models of genetic variation and models of the effect of genetic variation to kind of help this problem.
Okay, so yeah, just to summarize then, the goal really of this work is to try and aid in the genetic diagnosis of rare disease patients. And in particular, we are interested in the very long tail of extremely rare diseases for which even in these large cohorts, we might be seeing only one individual with a given genetic disorder. And the sort of approach that we've taken here is to say that, well, if we had a model that could predict the effect of genetic variation on a protein-wide scale, then we could basically take the variants seen in any given patient, feed them to the model, score the variants according to their likelihood of being the pathogenic variant. And if we had such a model, we would basically be able to say which, if any, variants are the cause without having to worry about the structure of the cohort at all. We'd be able to do this basically on a patient-by-patient basis. So yeah, the goal of this work is really to build a model that sort of takes us in that direction. And what we'll see is that, as we see it, at least the key concept here is a proteome-wide notion of pathogenicity. That is, we want to be able to take variants seen anywhere in exome sequencing and be able to sort of place them on some uniform scale, saying variants down one end of the spectrum are going to be sort of completely benign through to potentially pathogenic through to likely severely pathogenic variants. And the way we do this is a sort of modular, sort of two-step approach, where we leverage sequence variation on two sort of radically different evolutionary timescales. So the first timescale is to build models based on variation seen across sort of the tree of life. And these are models that are probably familiar to some of you. And then the second part, which is, I suppose, the newer part here, is to take the output of these sort of deep evolutionary models and use them as the input to another model, which now predicts the presence or absence of variants seen in the UK biobanks as reputed to be healthy individuals. And we'll see that by leveraging these sort of two different sources of genetic variation, we can build a sort of proteome-wide notion of pathogenicity. Okay, so I'll go through these sort of two stages one by one. So starting with these models of sequences from diverse organisms, this goes back to a very, very old idea. I mean, it's long been appreciated that if we take a protein of interest and we build a multiple sequence alignment of sequences from diverse organisms, and we see that at some position in the sequence, an amino acid has been conserved across millions of years of evolution, then intuitively we can expect that if we change that amino acid for one with very different properties, it's likely to disrupt the function of the protein. So really what we're trying to do with these models is kind of take this intuition and recast this as a probabilistic statement. And in this way, what we say is that the goal here is to model the distribution of these sequences. That is, the goal is to build some P of X, where X is the sequence. And if we can have a good model of the distribution of these sequences, then we can then go and take some new sequence, perhaps one that's never been seen before in nature, but perhaps it's a novel sequence seen in a patient. And we can ask how the sequence scores under this model. And we can just use something like the log odds to say, okay, well, how does this compare to some reference sequence? And the basic observation that's been sort of very fruitful in a wide range of applications is the realization that if the sequence is scored as very improbable with respect to the model, then that probably means that sequence codes for a protein whose function is in some way disrupted and therefore likely to be disease causing in this context. So what we do basically is there's been a number of ways of doing this over the years. And we can start to get some intuition by just going back to this notion of column conservation. So just taking that intuition described on the previous slide and sort of writing that as a probabilistic model, we would just say, well, okay, so we're just treating each position in the sequence as statistically independent. So we just sort of essentially collect the frequencies from each position. And then the probability of seeing a given sequence is just the product of all these probabilities per site, essentially. And this incredibly simple model actually it turns out to be extremely useful and is at the basis of many tools that are used in disease variant annotation, actually. On the other hand, in some ways, it's still an underappreciated model because actually you can do an awful lot with these models. Nevertheless, they do have some serious limitations. In particular, if you have a large multiple sequence alignment, then we know that there are richer notions of conservation than simple column conservation, in particular the sort of covariation signals between amino acids at different sites. And this, of course, is not something this model can capture, and hence this model easily becomes misspecified and therefore cannot fit the data distribution very well. So in recent years, we and other groups have been very interested in applying sort of more expressive models to this problem. And in doing so, we sort of feel like you can push this idea really quite a bit further. So one model that we make use of in this work and have used very heavily in the past is variational autoencoders. So the basic idea here, I'm not going to review variational autoencoders in any detail today, but the very, very high level view here is that well, sequence data is very high dimensional, awkward data to work with, but like many natural data sets, can often be represented quite faithfully in some lower dimensional space. So the idea is to say, okay, let's just make the hypothesis that the data was generated by some much smaller set of hidden variables. And in doing so, what we can basically do is write down a model where the conditional probability P of X given Z is a site-independent model. But now we integrate over Z. So this is essentially an infinite mixture model of site-independent models. And in doing so, if you're familiar with infinite mixture models, you'll know this is a very expressive way of building models of sequence distributions. Another class of model that we make very heavy use of in this project, but also has been very popular, especially in the sort of protein design world, are large kind of natural language processing inspired models. So models that, in contrast to the multiple sequence alignment based models I just described, here you train a single model on entire databases. So a single transformer that's trained on, you know, the entirety of UniRef 90, for instance. And in this work, these are actually incredibly valuable models for all sorts of reasons. It stops us being sensitive to the notion of a multiple sequence alignment, for one. And they're computationally quite efficient in some ways for this project, because the key thing here is that we want to build models of the entire proteome. So really to build a single model of all proteins in one go is actually a very computationally efficient way to do this. In practice, we make use of both classes of model in this project. So we make use of EVE, which is a model we developed previously, and transception, which is a model that we developed in this ICML paper, and then ESM1V, which is a wonderful model developed by the Meta group. And we'll make use of all three of them. Yeah. So I said that by moving to sort of more expressive models, we've been able to push this idea of sort of variant effect prediction a bit further, but how do we test this? In this work, we make very heavy use of kind of three different benchmarks. The first is comparison with the mutational scans. And the basic idea here is that in recent years, there's been a surge of interest in developing extremely high throughput functional assays. So assays that can score or probe the functional effect of, for instance, all possible single amino acid substitutions in a protein, or large numbers of combinations of variants and so on. So what we can do is directly compare the output from these experiments with the scores from our model. So we could predict the log odds for every single possible single amino acid substitution, if that's what the demutational scan does. And then we can just look at the correlation between the two. And quite often what we see is that the correlation between the experiment and the models is very nice. Now, of course, we don't do this just for one assay. We try to do this for as many assays as possible. And so we've actually spent quite a bit of time collecting, basically doing a megalomaniac literature search, collecting the data from now over 250 assays, standardizing the data, and now then using this as a way of sort of benchmarking models. And we now have this website, Protein Gym, where you can see a sort of leaderboard of lots of different models from the community and how they compare against all of the deep mutational scans, or you can sort of filter for ones that are just on viruses and so on. And this was originally introduced in this ICML paper here, but there's a big update coming soon. The second benchmark that we make use of, and that is a bit closer to the task at hand here, is comparison with clinical labels. So there's databases such as ClinVar, which have a large database of variants that have been classified as benign or pathogenic. And so what we can do is just simply see if the model has any ability to separate these variants. So what we've plotted here is variants as a function of position along the protein sequence. And then on the y-axis here, we have the score from Eve as an example, so the variational autoencoder. And what you see is that the model does a pretty good job of separating benign from pathogenic variants, so blues from reds. And the x's, by the way, are variants of uncertain significance, so variants that have been seen, but their interpretation is still unknown. And one of the sort of big surprises for us, I suppose, and one of the points that we were making in this paper here back in 2021, is that rather surprisingly, these models perform very much comparably to high-throughput experiments, but at a fraction of the cost, and also it can be done at enormously high throughput. So these form a very nice sort of complementary evidence to other approaches to trying to learn about the interpretation of these variants. However, there's a problem with these models. So you might ask, well, why can we not take these models directly and apply them to the problem of rare disease diagnosis? And the reason they're not, it gets you quite a long way there. I'd say it's a large chunk of the way there, but there's still a sort of key missing ingredient. And the reason for this is as follows. So the models do a great job at ranking the pathogenicity of variants within the protein, but they don't do a good job of comparing variants across proteins, which makes sense because the models were never designed to do that. I mean, in the case of the variational autoencoders, that's clear because you build a separate multiple sequence alignment for each protein. So the data set that they're trained on is completely separate. You train a different model. So it's not too surprising that the scores from one model are not too well calibrated or comparable to the one from the other. But the same is true even for the language models, actually. And even for these, the models do not do a particularly good job of comparing the sort of pathogenicity of variants across proteins. So to illustrate this, here's just one example. So here what we've plotted is all of the scores from single variants in a gene called MEF2C, which is a gene well known to be involved in very severe early onset neurodevelopmental disorders. Some variants are known to be lethal in mice. And now we're comparing it to all single variants in another olfactory receptor, which is, as far as we know, completely, all variants are completely benign or have no association, certainly not with severe disease. And what we see is that although there is this tail of more pathogenic variants in MEF2C, really the score distributions are pretty comparable. And our intuition would say that actually there should be a much more dramatic shift between the scores of variants in MEF2C with respect to ORF2A14. So to overcome this issue, this is where the second part of the model comes in. So this use of UK biobank data. And the basic idea here is that we have, when we look at whole exome data from the UK Biobank, we can see that there's many more variants in one protein than another, and that should, to some degree, tell us about the amount of constraint acting at the sort of at the gene level. And so what we can do is use that to actually build a new model that gives us variant level resolution data, but on a sort of new score that should be comparable across genes. So the workflow is sort of complete model, as it were, goes as follows. So we start with sequences from very diverse organisms. So something like UniRef90 as a database for training. If it's an alignment-based model, such as Eve or anything else, we then build multiple sequence alignments for every single protein of interest, and about 18,000 isoforms we work with here. And if we're working with a language model, then we just train the model directly on the entirety of this database. Then the next step is to compute the scores of every single amino acid substitution for every single protein. And so we get some distribution of scores per protein across the whole proteome, as it were. And now finally, what we do is we take those scores and we look at the relationship between those scores and the prevalence or the existence, as it were, of those variants in the UK biobank. So in particular, what we try to do is we build a model that tries to predict whether or not a variant is present or absent on the UK biobank, conditioned on the score from these underlying models. So it's just a Bernoulli distribution where we have some function F that's mapping these scores from this underlying model to get us the probabilities of seeing or not a variant in the UK biobank. And the way we do this is using a Gaussian process. I've forgotten a logit here. So yeah, the argument of the Bernoulli function should be the logit of F, not F, sorry about that. And then F itself is drawn from a Gaussian process. And so what you get is for each protein, we infer some function F, where you take the score for from the underlying model, and then we get map it to some new score, which we call the POPI score, which now takes these sort of score ranges that were perhaps comparable across different proteins, and now moves onto a new score range, which is now comparable across the entire proteome. And we see that sort of per protein, some scores will take a fairly small number of range, a small range, whereas for other proteins, it'll be a much larger range. So now if we go back to our example of MEF2C and ORF2A, here before we had the evolutionary score from Eve in this example. And now with the new model, we see that these scores have been shifted. So now we have something much more like we would expect, which is that in MEF2C, there's many, many variants that have a much more pathogenic score. So more negative is more pathogenic in this convention compared to ORF2A 1.4, as we'd expect. And then just to give another sort of reassurance another sort of more proteome-wide notion that this is sort of doing what we would expect. Here, what we've compared are genes that are known to be involved in disease and are autosomal dominant. And we compare the cumulative distribution of the minimum scores in those genes to the cumulative distribution of scores in genes that are so far not associated with disease and are sort of thought to be loss of function tolerant. And what we see is that the cumulative distribution reassuringly is nicely shifted for the haploinsufficient genes.
Right, so I guess these properties kind of indicate that the model is behaving as we would expect. But I guess the question is, how can we test that the model is actually capturing this notion of pathogenicity across the whole proteome? Or in other words, how can we build a benchmark or a validation exercise that is closer to the task that we have at hand, that is diagnosing patients with based on their variants? So for that, we developed this benchmark exercise. And the idea here is to distinguish patients with severe developmental disorders from controls. And the idea is that if we can identify patients based on their sequences, it's because we are being able to identify putative diagnosis for these patients. And for this, again, we are using these 31,000 patients with severe developmental disorders. And as control, we're using the variants, the de novo variants of unaffected siblings of patients with autism spectrum disorder. And here in this plot, what you can see is the minimum score per person. So the variant with the lowest POPI score, as we call it, per person. And what we can see is that at the end of more benign variants, patients and controls are not really distinguishable. But in the end of most pathogenicity, you really see that patients have variants that no controls have. So we can really distinguish patients from controls. And this is kind of what we would expect, because we don't expect all patients to be ill due to a missense de novo variant. And on the other hand, we also don't expect all of our controls to be perfectly healthy. So we would really expect there to be some overlap, but reassuringly, we find a regime on which we have a huge enrichment of these pathogenic variants in patients compared to controls. So we we can use this exercise or benchmark to compare different models. And here we're comparing our POPIF model with other models that are very used by the human genetics community. And we can see that the model performs quite well, particularly in this regime here, the regime of high accuracy. So it's this regime of lowest or more pathogenic variants where we really can distinguish patients from versus controls. In particular, if we look at the regime of variants below minus 5.2, we find that we can, this is not exactly, we can see that we have 99% likelihood of identifying variants that belong to the patient distribution and therefore that are probably pathogenic and drawing, leading the disease. This sort of enrichment in the patient cohort has a direct, we can see this directly in the enrichment across the cohort. So if you remember here, this is a plot that I showed right at the beginning that shows across the cohort, the enrichment of missense variants. And you see that there is a 2.3-fold enrichment. And now if we look at the enrichment of variants below this minus 5.2 threshold, we see that we have an 11 or 12-fold enrichment in variants. So this gave us some reassurance that the model was working. And also it will have, as I will show in a second, direct impact on how we can do burden tests using this model. Okay, so now that we have this model and we build some confidence that the model is working, we can go and do exactly what we said we wanted to do, that is to try to help identify new diagnoses for these patients. And we can do this with two different approaches. One of the approaches is to look on a patient-by-patient basis and just basically thresholding every variant below a given threshold. Here we're using minus 5.2 because we saw that we had this accuracy of 99.9% accuracy. And this approach has the advantage of being able to be applicable to patients even if we don't have a cohort, right? So if you just have like the exome of a single patient, we can just say, oh, this variant is likely to be pathogenic, and we call this sort of ab initio or variant threshold approach. And on the other hand, we can also try to leverage this extra power that we get from these models to do gene level collapse and do gene level burden. So if you remember, this is our expression for burden from earlier, basically just the probability of seeing a given number of variants given the cohort size and the background mutation rates. But now we can multiply this by the by this term that basically is just what is the probability of seeing a sum of the POPIV scores for all the variants that is smaller or more pathogenic than the one that we observe given this number of variants. And using this approach, we basically get extra statistical power on this burden test. So when we apply these two methods to the cohort, what we see is that we recover a lot of known genes that are known to be involved in developmental disorders. So here in magenta are the things that are identified, genes that are identified by variant threshold, and in blue, the genes that are identified by gene collapse. And everything that is checkered here are the genes that are identified by both, both approaches at the same time. And you see that we recover a lot of genes that are already known to be involved in disease. And we also recover 100 or order 100 novel genes. And this is something that we're very excited about. You see that using these just by having this extra power on the gene level burden, we can recover 21 new genes. And using these thresholds, we see order 100 novel genes. So what exactly do we do with this? So the first, we can have a look at our discoveries and try to make sense of what we saw. And just to give you some examples, I won't go into too much detail in this, but you can see that our top hit in a novel gene is a mutation in ARF3 that is of the RAS family, highly expressed in brain, so not totally surprising that it would be involved in developmental disorders. And our mutation is involved in the GTP hydrolysis or in the binding site of GTP. The second top heat is in an ion channel, in this particular case, a calcium-gated potassium ion channel. And the variants that we see and that are very pathogenic is a variant that is involved exactly at the pore where this potassium binds the ion channel. And these ion channels, again, they're super cool proteins. They're involved in lots of different processes in the human body, from signaling, electric signaling in heart to signaling in the brain. So again, not totally surprising that it would be involved in developmental disorders. And because this ion channel is calcium gated, we have calmodulin binded to this or interacting with this protein. And we also find two pathogenic mutations exactly where the calcium basically binds to this protein. So this is the kind of analysis that we can do to try to make sense of the putative discoveries that we made. And just to basically close this talk, I just wanted to take a step back and really think about what these results mean, not just for developmental disorders, but what is the spectrum of pathogenicity across the whole human proteome. So we have about 18,000 genes currently, models for human genes in the human proteome. And of all of these, we see that about half of them don't have any variant below minus 5.2 or minus 4.5 that we are calling moderate pathogenic. I mean, it's just a word. But the other half do have variants that are pathogenic. But what we find particularly interesting is that the vast majority of these genes have only a small percentage of their variants to be pathogenic. This means that the model is implying that across the whole human proteome, there's a very large number of genes with a very small number of very pathogenic variants, meaning that approaches like burden test, GWAS, et cetera, will always be underpowered to identify disease that is related to these variants. So I think that this kind of hints at the potential of these models of sequence variation that I guess we all in this community have been thinking about and really thinking about the impact that they can have for this community and for this problem and really be impactful in the diagnostic care of patients. So I think that this is kind of like a direction that is exciting for all of us to think about.
So that brings us to the end, really. So just to conclude, our lab is very much involved in developing models to predict the effect of variation, genetic variation, very broadly defined. But here we've zoomed in on rare disease, and in particular, this idea that interpretation of missense variants seems to be a quite severe bottleneck to current genetic diagnosis pipelines. So to try and overcome this, we've tried to develop a complementary approach to burden testing, which is a sort of proteome-wide model of pathogenicity. And as we see it, the key concept here is being able to rank variants anywhere in the proteome on some sort of kind of consistent scale. So I think sort of conceptually, as it were, it's a sort of a move from protein level modeling to sort of the first baby steps of whole proteome modeling. But even this very simple model, it seems to be quite useful, we think. In particular, we find this large enrichment of variants with severely pathogenic scores in this cohort, suggesting that this model provides really quite compelling evidence for sort of first steps towards genetic diagnosis. Future directions that we're very interested in are, well, what does this mean for other classes of disease? Can this say anything about a more complex disease? And we're also very interested in how this sort of how they score, which we're still sort of, I'm trying to understand this, the meaning of a sort of continuous score correlates with things like sort of continuous traits. And then finally, this work was done in collaboration with Debbie Marks's lab, which was our previous lab back in Harvard, and in particular with a very talented student, Rose Ehrenbuch, and also Aaron Kolasch, Jack Bludis, Hans Binner, and Thomas Hoff. And finally, we're hiring. So yeah, if you'd like to come and join us in beautiful Barcelona and develop models of effective genetic variation, then I think our office is that one there. So yeah, we're hiring all levels, so please get in touch. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. So do we have questions? There was one question in the chat by Patrick, I think. Maybe Patrick, you want to say to ask directly? No? Should I read?
Yeah, we can also read. So basically, Patrick is asking that when you look at the average spearman across all of these experiments in protein gym, that the very best average spearman is 0.5, and a very reasonable question of asking if this is considered accurate. I think that this is a very interesting question and really points to, I'm gonna try to go back to this plot to aid this. Okay, sorry. So there's a lot of very interesting questions related to how can we.
Sorry, I'm just trying to find it. Why can't I see it once?
Oh,
there we go.
But I wanted to actually show this one.
Oh, sorry, sorry.
Yeah. the usage of deep mutational scans to benchmark these models. So, first of all, deep mutational scans are extremely noisy, most of them. Or not extremely, but there's a lot of experiments that are very noisy and have actually poor replicates. So, for technical replicates and even biological replicates. So you would have imagined that ideally we could normalize the experiment by at least that biological replicate. But this is something that we are not currently doing in protein gene because it would be hard to basically do it across all of the experiments, and there's not all of the data is provided in that way when we are basically parsing all of these papers and all of these studies. So we basically decided not to do this. Another thing is that computing averages over all of these experiments is very misleading as well. And I think that it's kind of a necessity that we resorted to it in the protein gym website, but it's very misleading in the sense that some experiments will, it is possible to achieve a higher spearman, not just because of the replicate and quality of the data, but also because of the ceilings and floors of the data. So the dynamic range of the experiment will have a limited dynamic range because at some point you don't see more pathogenic because your cells die or because you simply don't see the expression of a given protein depending on the assay. And here you release, and the experiment, whereas the model does not have a notion of floor. And this basically just has a direct impact on the maximum spearman that you would, even to start with, be able to capture. And even though I'm saying all of these things, it's also true that for many of the experiments, the correlation between model and the experiment, it's extremely poor. And it could be for multiple reasons. For some, you know, what is the model capturing, right? Is a conservation, its constraints across evolutionary experiments. So it's like convolution of all types of different constraints on this protein family, whereas the experiment is looking at one particular constraint. So it might be that the model and the experiment are looking at orthogonal or at least part of the constraints that the model is actually capturing.
That's a really tricky topic, yeah. Actually. So when we've been collecting these demutational scans, we're up to whatever, 250 yeah. demutational scans now, but there are many, many, many more out there in the world. And when we're building this database, we're trying to make a judgment call about whether or not the assay is actually probing anything kind of relevant to the fitness prediction that task of the models are trying to build. And this is a tricky topic because in many cases it will be capturing some element of fitness, but definitely not the whole picture. But it's a hard judgment call to make because on the one hand, we don't want to cherry pick, so we try to be quite inclusive. But on the other hand, sometimes it could be that it's just not really capturing a relevant phenotype. That's a possibility.
And one last comment before we move away from these deep mutational scans. This has been in our perspective, kind of a useful tool as a benchmarking tool, really, for model development, for trying to understand how the model is doing, etc. And It's been useful, and I believe it's useful even for exercises such as protein design and other questions that are related to protein fitness. Now, we are, in this talk at least, we were primarily talking about disease phenotypes. So when we, so protein gene has 250 deep mutational scans, but really when we did this experiment on trying to check how the model compares against deep mutational scans in human proteins, that was basically about 15. So it's a...
Now with the new database, it's more.
But it's
back in 2021, we had like 50.
Yeah, but it's still not, you know, it's not order of hundreds, it's order of dozens. So really, I think that the way we should think about these benchmark exercises is not in itself like a single benchmark, but a useful one. So just for a few genes, a very deep notion of what is happening on that gene. Whereas, for example, ClinVar or the benchmark of distinguishing patients from controls is really something that captures the pathogenicity across different genes, but it's pretty sparse in each gene. So it's kind of like different.
So yeah, this example here where we've got loads of variants is because it's in P53, you know, it's a...
Yeah, normally it doesn't look like
this. It's a rock star gene involved in cancer, but for the vast majority of genes involved with disease, we have, you know, we're lucky to have 5 benign and 5 pathogenic,
yeah.
You know, so it gets hard to get performance tests. I mean, for most genes, it's hard to get reliable performance estimates with this kind of data.
You have too little data to really say how accurate this would be.
Sorry, can you say that again?
What you're saying is you have too little data to really evaluate this problem. Do I know when to trust? Because if the average correlation is 0.5, I mean, you say sometimes it's higher. I mean, of course, that's evident. But how can I know when to trust evaluation?
Right. So what I suppose is slightly, there's a few different tasks going on here. So I think if it's the task of trying to assess if one model is better than another model, then it's relatively easy because we can take lots of proteins and we can just look per protein when model is doing better than another. Now, whether or not the model is good enough for a given protein to be trustable, to assess if a variant is pathogenic or not, that's definitely a much more subtle issue. There's been some recent papers specifically on this that are really interesting. It's from the ClinGen recommendation group. And basically there's different strategies. One approach is to look in aggregate across all proteins. So then you have, of course, thousands and thousands of variants. And you can get an overall notion of how well the model's performing. But of course, we really expect the model's performance to vary from one protein to another. Like we fully expect that we should be able to build beautiful models for some proteins and not for others. And whether or not we can do that with the accuracy required for diagnosis or for variant annotation more generally, we're basically bound by the quality of labels out there to assess. So yeah, for instance, for P53, we can do a very detailed assessment of the performance of the model, but there's some other genes which, at least at present, we just don't know how good the model is yet.
Yeah, so kind of something that we've been really trying to bring home with the clinical community is that models, or the weight that each model should take for aiding diagnosis or for annotating a variant as being benign or pathogenic, really should depend on how much validation data there is for that gene.
Yeah.
Rather than a general statement on the weight of a model for any gene, which is currently how it is currently done by the clinical community, which because of what we're discussing.
Yeah, we'd encourage changing, or at least some sort of hybrid of the two. I mean, I think both things are useful, but
yeah.
Surely for genes with lots of labels, you should be able to get a cleaner statement about the strength of evidence provided by the model. Who's next?
I think I was next in the chat. So my in the biobank data, I think that, I mean, I don't know if it's a problem. Like, of course, if something is lethal, you will never see it. If something is too bad. Like, so somehow it's like when you find disease genes, or disease mutations, you want to find the bad one, but not too bad ones. And I mean, is that a problem in these models, or is there something that can be affected, or does it, or can you predict the lethal ones also?
So the way we built the model was very much with that in mind. So the idea here is that you're just saying what's the probability of observing a variant somewhere in the protein conditioned on its score. And, you know, if we look to sort of the inferred functions, we get something like this. So the probability is going to scale with this function. So for scores that are sort of predicted benign by the underlying model, there should be quite a large number of variants present in the UK biobank. And then as we go down, there should be less and less until eventually there's none. And the nice thing about the Gaussian process is we get some notion of uncertainty as we move into that regime. We played around with different models because the key thing for this whole project, it really is sort of characterization of that sort of pathogenic tail. And actually, we found that this was on the plus side of using something like a Gaussian process as opposed to like pure logistic regression, is that it seems to be less prone to over predicting pathogenic variants, which is kind of a known issue with these things. So that was basically the philosophy behind the model, is that it doesn't need to see variants in that regime. It just needs to see some variants somewhere. And then after that, it's just a simple rescaling of the score. So it's most of the properties of them in terms of per variant ranking within the protein, that's really driven by the underlying model. So the performance of the model on that, at that task is driven by, you know, EVE or ESM1B. And really the task of the second step is just to recalibrate, to rescale it. So it's a very sort of simple transformation of the score. And hence we don't need much data.
And you didn't really ask this, but I'm just going to comment on it. We hope that by building a model in this way, the model is not too sensitive by the biases that are in the UK Biobank data, which is kind of like a related question to what you're saying. One of the biases could be that a lot of the people are above a certain age, but mostly importantly for the usual biases of human genetic problems are the population biases. Most of people in the UK Biobank are from a white European ancestry. And we didn't include any of the plots, I don't know.
No, I think we might have that actually.
But anyway, it doesn't really matter the plots. Basically, we've really been trying to really question the, we believe that the model is not very sensitive to population biases because of what exactly Johnny just described. So it's basically just a rescaling and we don't need to see all the variants. But we're really trying to probe this question and to try to convince ourselves that this model is applicable or generalizable to all ancestries. Yeah, we're also collaborating with some people working with rare disease patients in Africa to try to really test this, I guess. Yeah.
Thank you. So there was, Chen, you can go ahead maybe, and then there is a question in the chat.
Thank you. I would first like to say that it was a great talk. A really great talk, and I'm working on mutations from very different angle inputs. Really fascinating.
Thank you. A
second thing is that when I figure out about protein gene, it made me very happy. So I understand you're part of the team, of that team. So many thanks. It's a great resource. And the last thing is just a comment about a very recent publication. I sent it in the chat. It's a huge cDNA library. And the overall, first of all, it's huge and larger than anything that I'm aware of, including protein gene. It's a single experiment. And it doesn't suffer. I mean, I'll be very happy to hear what you see there, but it seems that it doesn't suffer from the major problems that you've just mentioned about the data of protein gene. These are calculations. They try to calculate actual delta delta G. I don't have yet the impression how accurate is this estimation of delta delta G, but it's the real thing. It's not survivals or growth of cells, which, as you already said, it includes a lot of factors that protein stability or mutant differences in stability is only part of.
Yes.
So I think it's a huge resource to this community.
Absolutely. No, this is amazing data. And we are in the process of trying to integrate it in ProteinGym as well. So for folding stability related questions of thermal stability, et cetera, I think that this is really the gold standard for benchmarking models on. And it's quite the effort and just because of the breadth of it, I guess, just how huge it is. I think it's just absolutely amazing data. And yes, we're in the process of including it in the model.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree. I suppose something we're always very mindful of is that any given benchmark, I guess the hope in designing a benchmark is that it reflects the downstream task as closely as possible. So I think all of these benchmarks, they have their different pros and cons, and they're more relevant for some applications than for others. So for instance, in the context of rare disease, we're very much focused on the effect of a single like point mutation. Whereas for instance, in protein design, people are often interested in walking very large distances in protein space. And it's conceivable that a model that's good at one is terrible at the other and vice versa. It's not necessarily true that you would have a good model of all of these things at once. So yeah, I think we really need sort of different complementary ways of probing these models to gain intuition about what they can and what they can't do. And also just to match downstream applications.
Yeah. Yeah. So really for large steps in design, interested in questions like thermal stability and stability in general, this is great data to test. You might be interested in binding to ligands, antibody design, kind of like a different questions. And I think the way to utilize the data out there is just to be very thoughtful, like Johnny said, about your downstream task and what exactly do you want to test your model on and for which, yeah, what's your objective. It's all about building interesting and good validation experiments, right? That are closer to your task. I guess that's where always
the tricky part.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. So there was also a question in the chat from Conan, if you want to ask, or about the number of parameters, layers you have in the prediction model, and how big the training data are or needs to be to make the model sufficiently efficient, and also what are the usual statistical metrics, like true positive, false positive, the recall.
Yeah, so in terms of how much data we need, this is a really tricky question. And also it depends on which part of the model we're talking about tremendously. So a big question, let's see, let's start, I guess, at the top of this figure and work our way down. So we've got at the top, we've got UniRef 90, which has, hundreds of thousands of proteins, not millions. Is it millions?
That's millions, yeah.
I can't remember now. but then if we're building a per protein level model, so building on multiple sequence alignments, then yeah, a huge question for these models is how many sequences you're going to get in that multiple sequence alignment, and also what is the quality of that multiple sequence alignment. And I think something that was a pleasant surprise for us is that we didn't need as much data as we were expecting. So can't remember the hyperparameters of Eve off the top of my head. It was three layers of thousands of parameters per layer, filtering to hundreds. I can't remember exactly offhand. And it was a symmetric, the encoder and decoder was symmetric for this model. We're talking in the ballpark of thousands of parameters for that model. And then both the language models are in the sort of mid millions of parameters. These are not billion parameter models yet. I think there are some emerging now. And I think it's unclear what is the amount of data that's needed. I think there's many, many, many issues here. So there's a big question about the relatedness of the sequences. So a key problem for all of these models is that the data is, of course, not independently and identically distributed. It has this beautiful, rich phylogenetic structure. And we've sequenced some parts of the tree of life much more heavily than others. So there's all sorts of sampling biases. So it's not just how much data we have, but it's also the relatedness of those sequences, how they span the tree of life, what's the evolutionary history of that protein. All of these things are factors in what will ultimately allow us to make a good model of a given protein, be it with a language model or an alignment-based model. In sort of practical terms, we've seen that we can get very good models even with kind of a few hundred sequences. But sometimes we have tens of thousands of sequences and or even some examples with hundreds of thousands of sequences in the alignment. And yeah, we can in principle get good models from all of these. I think one nice thing about the VAE is that it's sufficiently expressive that it is quite versatile with regard to this data set. But we are also interested in building very, very lightweight models as well. So we're also thinking about models that can move into kind of the wide range, small numbers of sequences. And what's the most we can do with very limited numbers of sequences? There's been some really interesting work from ProGen group, right? So they did some scaling analysis and they kind of reached the opinion that it's not really about getting more data at this point. It's more that we need to think about how we curate the data for the reasons I described. So that's a very cool paper. I wonder if we can dig it up. And then, okay, so when we get to the next layer.
Well,
so
wait, I just want to make a last comment here that it's something, it's more of a evidence that we've been seeing, but I think that it would be nice for us to probe more carefully. We were really excited about the usage of these large language models that train on the entire protein universe to basically gain power exactly on those proteins for which we have very very shallow alignments or for disordered regions, for example. And we were hoping that by having a model that is training the whole protein universe, that it would be less sensitive to the depth of the multiple sequence alignment, because there's no multiple sequence alignment. But what we see, and this is something that I think that we should be doing a little bit more carefully and quantitate this a little bit more, but it's so far it's kind of like the evidence that we have, is that the models, the language models also perform more poorly when there is for regions and for proteins for which it's harder to build good multiple sequence alignments. And this is not totally surprising, right? Even though it doesn't use a multiple sequence alignment, it's still, the model is still learning some sort of a notion of a protein family within the universe, the protein universe, right? And it's basically telling you that those regions of the protein universe are harder to model. And I think that that's kind of interesting in a sense for us a little bit. Yeah, we were hoping that we would have solved the problem of disordered proteins and so on, and it doesn't seem to be the case. But I think that this is something that we can think a little bit more deeply and try to quantitate. And I don't know if you had similar experiences in...
So I think it's perfectly in line with what was observed in the last CASP edition, that these, in the end, these language models are not exactly compensating for the lack of homologs or homologous sequences. And so question related to this would be, since you're using these population data essentially to shift the prediction, can you use them for in some way for compensating where you don't have information from species or not?
Yeah, no, this is a great question. And yeah, so I think the short answer is that there's not too much cause for optimism, because the reality is that, I mean, human sequences are just incredibly similar to each other compared to this sort of sequence variation we're seeing across the tree of life. So, you know, we're seeing sort of point mutation variation between individuals. So there's not really that much information there. Like, we wouldn't be able to build a VAE off human data alone, for instance. That said, there was one very, very interesting paper recently from Illumina. Well, actually they've had two papers on this now, but there was a big update recently from Illumina on a model called Primate AI. And now the new one's called Primate AI 3D, I think. And
they sequence hundreds of primates.
Yeah, this is the thing. So they collect this incredibly beautiful data set of basically sequencing an enormous number of primates. And I think a big question is what information can be extracted from that data? Because that's living in some intermediate regime. We've got sort of the human data, which tells us some things, but it of course lacks diversity in other regards. Then we've got the sequences across the tree of life, which are extremely diverse. And yet we managed to extract useful information from that too. And then, yeah, of course, I think the big question is what could we learn from these intermediate scales of like primate type scales of variation?
Yeah, unfortunately, the data is not public yet, even though the paper is already out. So hopefully one day we will be able to have a look because it's really interesting.
Yeah.
And okay, I want to say a comment on this before I forget. What was it? Something that we did here was to... in a sense, preserve, because this function is monotonic, we preserve the ranking within proteins. And something that we can think about for the future is to try actually to leverage information that is in human that we wouldn't see in deep evolution. In particular, things like splice disrupting variants that we know that are only present in very recent evolutionary time scales. Really, they're almost like human specific, sometimes even cell type specific. Anyway, we won't go there for now. But can we try to leverage that and incorporate that in our model? And this is something that we didn't try to leverage in this current construction. And it's not exactly what you were asking, Elodie, but it's you can see like it's related and
yeah, definitely. Yeah. Okay, thanks. So I think we approached the end because it's supposed to be just 1 hour. So maybe we should close the session.
Mel, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Very interesting discussion as well.
Thank you very much. I agree. And as I said in the beginning, if someone has proposed of a good speaker for the next few meetings, just send an email to me.
Thank you very much for having us. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.